My name is Pastor Tom Glasso. If you don't remember, I was here a couple weeks ago. So I'm the bald guy. I don't know if you remember, but I'm glad to be back with you, and it's my honor to serve you. Sometime in the service, I expect my family to come trudging through, so ignore them when they make all the noises. But if I haven't had a chance to meet you, please let me allow me to meet you after the service and let me get to know you. Today's service is the continuation of the Matthew story, and I'm so grateful that we have something better looking than me up here with the flowers, and please continue that with sponsoring the flowers that are here for this year. I see that we also sponsor our bulletins and so forth, so if you are able, please assist us in doing so to help make worship much more meaningful for all those who are here, visitors and friends and family. There is the Wesley Food Pantry that is in need of your constant support, our support. So if you are able, either support it through your resources or through your sweat. They're always in need of them, of volunteers. So if those cold, gloomy January days are getting to you, go serve God's people. It always brightens up my day when I'm able to do so. And so what else am I forgetting? Let me look. Yeah. Oh, congregation meeting. It'll be next week. So the good news is that if I remember correctly, the championship games don't start until later in the afternoon. So we can have all day meeting if we need to, okay? But it starts sometime after the late service. So Neil, you'll be here and play and entertain us through it, okay? But it'll be at 12:30, whenever the service is over. There's a light meal that's going to be served as part of that, so please come and be part of this important meeting as we set the agenda for the year and what our goals and visions are, or at least that's what we do, of the congregations I've served, and I assume that's what you also do. So be part of the of that important conversation, and that's happening next week after the second service. And then, let me see, is there anything else? Oh, Second Mile, yes, lastly, they are in need of our support, and there's envelopes and such for your financial contributions, so feel free, and please, if you are able, help Second Mile in any way, shape, or form. And so with that, let us prepare our hearts and our minds as we worship our Lord now. We are gathered in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Trusting in God's mercy, let us confess our sin. Holy One, source of our renewal, we confess that we are wrapped up in sin and cannot free ourselves. We have not practiced your righteousness. Our hearts have turned away from you. For the sake of the world you so love, forgive us that you may be reconciled to one another for the glory of your holy name. Amen. No, our sins are forgiven in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. God. Our opening hymn is We Are Called. Thank you. grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Jesus taught many things that help people know how deeply you love humanity. Help us to live in your love so that we might be beacons of light for others. We pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
A reading from the Gospel of Matthew, beginning at the 5th chapter. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up to the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him, and he began to speak and taught them, saying, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who persecuted for the sake of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you, falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. People do not light a lamp and put it under the bushel basket rather than put it on a lampstand and give its light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law of the prophets. I have come not to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, no one letter, not one stroke of a letter will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. The gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Dear Lord, we're so grateful that we can gather in your holy space to worship and to praise you. And we ask you, Lord, now to descend upon us, spirit of wisdom, spirit of understanding and counsel. And may the words that are spoken have the power to renew and transform us according to your will, so that we may be able to be greater disciples in this world. In your name we pray. Amen. So today is one, our reading is one of the most famous texts in all the Bible. Most of us, whether we are regular church attendees or not, probably have heard this text sometime in our life and probably multiple times in our lives. This text, the word that comes, that sticks out for every one of us is the word bless. It's repeated 9 times in this short text. So, of course, it would stand out. But let me share with you a little bit about what it means, blessing, in the Bible. What you notice is that the act of blessing is one of the oldest acts in the Bible. It goes all the way back to the very early pages of the Old Testament. Even Adam and Eve are blessed by God. Even after they leave the Garden of Eden, they are blessed. Cain was blessed. And then you get down to Abraham and so forth. And what I've learned, if you read the entire Bible and you pay attention, there are two types of blessings that I can identify, I can figure out in the Bible. The first one is the general blessing, a blessing for safety, blessing for certain activity or events. And these are the kind of blessings that we're most familiar with. Whenever somebody sneezes, what do you say? Bless you, right? Or in German, it's, you know, Gesundheit, right? And then there are, you know, those types of blessings that we tend to share with each other as a reaction more than something deeper. Though it's probably meant how it is said, but still, it's more of a reactive blessing. There's also the type that I hear that if somebody's doing something that's hard or struggling, people say, oh, bless you for whatever you're doing, right? So those are the general blessings. Those are the ones we tend to think of. But what I find is that not all, but a lot of the blessings in the Bible are what I call identifier blessings. These are the blessings that identifies the person who's being blessed as God's own, especially in the Bible. This is when Cain, he is marked on his body. He's blessed by God that he will live a life that where no one will hurt him. Jacob, he is hip bone. He is blessed through the hip bone. And this is God's way of saying, you are mine, no one will touch you. We remember that Abraham, when he's brought out from his tent under the dark sky with the stars up above, and God says, look at all the stars, you will be blessed to the thousandth generation, and you will be the father of a great nation. And he is reminding Abraham that he is identified as the father of God's nation. And then you go on down and you get David, who is all alone, shepherding his father's flock. And it is Samuel who calls him, and he blesses him, identifies him as the as a king of Israel and a child of God. And so you go on down and you see blessings after blessings in the Old Testament where God identifies through the act of blessing the person as an instrument, a prophecy, or a voice of wisdom and counsel for God. And so what you see over and over again in the Old Testament is the act of blessing is often and mostly an act of God identifying his people as his. And so when you go down to the New Testament, though, the people in the Old Testament that are blessed when they are blessed, they are given great wealth, great riches, and great power. In the New Testament, Jesus comes, and the first act of blessing that we see is Jesus at his baptism, and he is blessed by God. And this is when the dove comes down and says, you are my beloved, with whom I am well pleased. And if you read the book of Mark, when the dove comes down, it doesn't just come down quietly and alights on Christ. Mark uses the word that the heaven was torn open. It was a violent, impatient event. God had to come down and immediately did it. And so what you get the sense is that in that particular moment, the blessing was immediate and it was extremely important to God. And so you get the sense that blessing for God is really a critical tool that he uses to identify and engage with his people, and especially Jesus, his son. And so from then on, that sets the pattern for Jesus' ministry, that sets out and marks Jesus as this significant and important person that walks amongst God's people. But what you see as you go on is that whenever there are other blessings, God marks people as identifiers for what the new creation, the new world looks like. And so for Jesus in today's gospel text, he blesses people the world would never ever bless, regardless of culture, regardless of what era of history we are in. Nobody would ever bless the poor. Nobody would ever bless the peacemakers. Nobody ever bless the meek. And yet, it is Christ who signifies the importance of these people and identifies them as these people being the critical people for God. He sets out and reminds us that if we want to be like Christ, like God, we ought to be about peacemaking, be meek and humble, and be engaged with others who are struggling with grief and loss and whatever it is that they're dealing with. And what you get is that we go from blessing as a sign of wealth, a sign of power, and sign of might, to a New Testament where Jesus turns it upside down, and at the end of the day, he says, I've come to fulfill the law. The law now has been turned upside down to a point where now Christ is saying the law is not about any of that stuff, but it's really about compassion. It's about engagement. It's about accompanying. It's about being with one another in deep, committed spiritual relationship with one another. And And so the blessings that you get in the New Testament is about engaging and being in relationship with one. It's not a reaction to a sneeze. It's not a reaction to some story that you hear that you feel you need to respond in some compassionate way. It is now an invitation into a deeper engagement and a committed in spiritual connection with that person. Blessing for Christ is not a one-time event. It is an always event, an everlasting event. When you bless someone, you are in a way identifying them as your friend, as your committed, engaged partner in ministry. And for Christ to be blessed means that you have now been marked with the seal of Christ, as we say at baptism, and we now are engaged in the works of the Lord. So blessing in the Christian sense is really about opening ourselves into relationships, a godly relationship with one another. And so when we think of blessing, I invite you to really think about it in terms of being in relationship with God's people, with God and with each other. It reminds us of that text. It reminds us of that, of the great commandment, where we are told to always love God and love our neighbors. It goes hand in hand always. It's not one or the other. It's always both. And so the blessing in Matthew 6, it's the beginning of Christ's ministry. In a way, it's him starting to teach his disciples and all those who hear him that we are now not about everything else that you have been taught, but it's really about being in committed spiritual relationship with one another. And so I invite you in this day and this week to really ponder what that means to be a blessed child, because you all have been blessed. I assume you all are baptized, right? You have been blessed at least once in the context of a church, and that's at your baptism. Because after we pour water on you, the next thing the pastor says is, you are a child of God. And we say a blessing. I can't remember it right now, but we say a blessing over you. And then we remind you that you are a child of God, and that you, and we make a mark, the seal of Christ on your forehead, and we say that you are claimed by God. Okay? And so I invite you. But there's a practice I want to invite you to do, and I've been thinking about doing this, and I keep forgetting to do it. But in the Jewish faith, on the Sabbath, on Friday night after their Sabbath dinner, the dad always goes around to the children and the spouse, and he will put his hand on the children's shoulder, and he will say a blessing over that child. He will say what he was proud of that child for the week preceding that Sabbath dinner. And then he will say a blessing. And there's a blessing that's found in their prayer book. And they say, and the father goes around. One time I heard a rabbi speak about what that meant to him. And the rabbi said it's his most favorite moment in his entire week. And this was a rabbi, he said, when he was growing up, when he was in high school, he was a star basketball player. He had cute girlfriends, he said, and he and his family was extremely wealthy. And so he had no want, he had a perfect life, childhood, but he says there's nothing that he loved more than when the Sabbath dinner came and his dad blessed him, because he knew that his dad loved him. It was a mark of identifier that he was his dad's, and that it gave him inspiration and courage to head into the new week, knowing that whatever he does, he will never be far from his dad, and that his dad is paying attention to him. And that even beyond his dad, he knew that Yahweh, or God, was also walking beside him. And so for him, it brought him closer to the family and brought him closer to God. So I invite you, a practice. Do you have kids at home? I know you do. But do you have grandkids that you see regularly? If not, do so to your spouse or your animal, your cat or dog, whatever. But start the practice of intentional blessing, not just when someone sneezes or not as a reactive, but as a part of our lives. Start blessing one another, because if there's anything that will bring us closer as a congregation, as a community, as a priesthood of all believers, is the act of intentional blessing. Bless one another so that others may know that they matter and that they belong to the great Lord our God. I invite you to take that, to adopt that in this week and in the days and weeks to come. Let us pray. Dear Lord, we're so grateful that you continue to love us, you continue to call us, you continue to gather us and enlighten us. But Lord, remind us always that we are your blessed children, that no matter where we go and what we do, you are always accompanying us, engaged with us, loving us, and being and committed to our lives. Give us courage, Lord. Give us strength to continue to live the blessed life you've given us, and help us to remember to always bless others as you have blessed us. Help us to be a blessing to others, always. And may they and all those we engage learn that you are also theirs, and that they are also claimed by you. In your name we pray. Amen. together in trust and hope, we now confess our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Called together to follow Jesus, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. Make your church one in purpose, proclaiming the message of the cross. Help us to work together across differences. Merciful God,
hear our prayer.
Be a stronghold for those in trouble and a rock for all who are afraid. Rouse communities to care for neighbors who need shelter, are facing maltreatment, or are isolated and lonely. Merciful God,
hear our prayer.
Sustain the ministries of this congregation and all churches in this community. Foster mutual respect. Inspire our cooperation in loving our neighbors. Merciful God,
hear our prayer.
Healing God, during this lingering pandemic, we pray that the Spirit will guide us to show patience, exercise flexibility, and care for our neighbors' physical and spiritual well-being. Inspire in us a spirit of sacrificial love and concern for one another, especially the most vulnerable. Merciful God, sustain healthcare workers, caregivers, first responders, counselors, and all who help and heal, especially Bishop Michael Lozano, those on our prayer list, and those we now name in your presence. Keep us mindful of the needs of others in our communities and neighborhoods. Merciful God, we give thanks for those who have died in Christ, especially Margaret Walsh, Preston Rhodes, Edith Vogt, Gertrude Tevis, Oliver Shadle Jr., Francis Pomeroy, trusting that we will be united with them and all saints in Christ's resurrection life. Merciful God, we pray for peace in the world, especially in Ukraine, and for the safety of all military personnel, especially those who have congregational ties. Merciful God.
O God, we bring you our needs and hopes, trusting in your wisdom and power revealed in Christ crucified. Amen. And now may the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share that peace with one another.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, and with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Faithfulness endures from age to age. Praise to you for creating the heavens and the earth. Praise to you for saving the earth from the waters of the flood. Praise to you for bringing the Israelites safely through the sea. Praise to you for leading your people through the wilderness to the land of milk and honey. Praise to you for the words and deeds of Jesus, your anointed one. And praise to you for the death and resurrection of Christ, and praise to you for your Spirit poured out on all nations. On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Let us now proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. O God of resurrection and new life, pour out your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and wine. Bless this feast. Grace our table with your presence. Reveal yourself to us in the breaking of the bread. Raise us up as the body of Christ for the world. Breathe new life into us. Send us forth, burning with justice, peace, and love. And with all your holy ones of all times and in places, and with the earth and all its creatures, with sun and moon and stars, and we praise you, O God, blessed and holy Trinity, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Let us now be bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Come, taste the joy of God.
You may be seated. body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you always in his name.
Amen.
We thank you for the healing that springs forth abundantly from this table. Renew our strength to do justice, love kindness, and journey humbly with you. Amen.
As you go on your way, remember always that God, who is faithful and just, bless you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, today and always.